The vast 35-inch curved gaming monitor from MassDrop sports a 3440 by 1440 ultra-wide resolution, 2-millisecond response time, and a 100Hz refresh rate with FreeSync technology for an unbelievably low price. Click the link in the description to learn more before the deal ends. What's going on, people? Welcome back. So today we're taking a closer look at December's PC of the month, which I assembled back in December. As you guys might remember, I didn't actually get the system to boot or even turn on at all because the power supply that Inwin had sent me actually shipped with a improper cable. So I was unable to show you guys the finished build all lit up, or, you know, semi lit up and with fans running and so forth. So today I ended up swapping that power supply out for a 500 watt EVGA 80 plus bronze unit, which is adequate for now as a temporary solution. Believe it or not, all my other power supplies are wrapped up in other builds at the moment. So I wouldn't recommend it for this particular system because we have some high end components in here that we are gonna be overclocking. So for long-term use, I would suggest a different power supply, but for the purpose of this video, it's probably fine. That being said, here it is. It boots. Look, it works. I'm gonna take the tempered glass side panel off. Since it's tinted, it's kind of hard to see the beautiful innards, but hey, there you go. A lot of people on Instagram are making fun of the fact that I only have a single fan in the middle up there, and it looks funny. I think it looks cool, so ha, joke's on you. Now, before we dive into what the system is actually capable of, I wanted to quickly go over, revisit the specs to give you guys a refresher since it has been a while since I built this. We've got an 1800X Ryzen 7 CPU, 8 cores, 16 threads, along with the GTX 1070 Ti from Gigabyte. The motherboard is a B350 Tomahawk from MSI paired with 16 gigs of G-Scale RipJaws 5 DDR4 at 2933 megahertz. Inside of the beautiful Inwin 303C case, unfortunately, as you guys saw in part one, I was unable to take advantage of that front panel USB-C port because the motherboard that I picked does not have a header for that. Also RGB, there's no RGB here because there's no RGB header on the motherboard either. I made a lot of mistakes in part one. The case, however, is getting plenty of airflow thanks to the help of our 5 Fractal Design Silent Series R2 fans. We've set 3 as intake at the bottom of the case, which is the only place where the Inwin 303 gets its intake from. The front panel's completely closed off. There's not even any fan mounts up there. We have 1 rear fan at the exhaust, or one exhaust fan at the rear, and then one more at the top, of course. And then I almost forgot to mention our CryoRig H5 cooler with a slim fan here, beautiful sort of off-white plating at the front, just makes it look really nice and cohesive with the rest of the build, along with these sleeved extensions from WazMods. He did an excellent job once again. Overall, a very, very, very nice system. I haven't configured the RGB lighting on the card yet, so it's kind of mismatched there. But other than that, that's sort of a refresher on December's PC of the month. Let's go ahead and talk about some overclocking. Starting with our 1800X, I was actually able to push that all the way to 4 gigahertz on all 8 cores very easily within MSI's UEFI. All I did was change the multiplier and didn't have to touch the voltage or the BCLK or anything like that. It was a very, very simple procedure. We've also got our memory running at 2933 just fine. Didn't do any overclocking there. I just wanted to hit the rated speed, which was also super simple within MSI's UEFI. Simply enabled an XMP profile, set the 2933 megahertz profile, and we were good to go. Didn't even have to fool around with cast latency timings or even input the voltage manually, anything like that. It was really straightforward, to be honest, which also goes to show that motherboard manufacturers are rolling out more and more updated BIOSes that are improving the support, the memory compatibility. There's less that the end user has to do in order to hit a memory kit's rated speed, which is also fantastic news. I was very impressed with the clock speeds we were able to hit on our GTX 1070 Ti from Gigabyte. If you guys recall the EVGA 1080 Ti that I took a look at earlier, I think we got a 140 megahertz offset on that, and I thought that was pretty good. Took us around to the very low 2000 megahertz range. But this guy was able to pull off 170 megahertz of a core clock offset, which actually took us all the way up to 2088 megahertz. I tweaked around with it a little bit and was able to hit 2.1 gigahertz at one point, but then that was proved unstable once we got around to Firestrike Extreme. So again, a 170 megahertz core clock offset with a 300 megahertz memory clock offset means that we're hitting some really nice clock speeds here. Overall, that was giving us around a 4 to 5%, or I'd say 3 to 5% increase in gaming performance strictly from overclocking the GPU. We'll take a look at performance, of course, in just a bit. That leads us right into thermals. So starting with our 1800X, we were seeing very favorable numbers in the 50 range. So 50 degrees Celsius, thereabouts, when we were putting a heavy load on it in GTA 5, Battlefield 1 at 2560 by 1440 for about half an hour in each game. Very nice numbers. I think the hottest we saw the CPU get was about 68 degrees Celsius. And that was, of course, just a random spike up to that number, and then it dropped back down to the 50s. So overall, the Cryorig H5 is doing a fantastic job of cooling this overclocked 8-core monster of a CPU. Our GPU is staying just as cool. I mean, quite literally, it's hitting 68 degrees Celsius at its hottest. And that's just like a random spike every now and then. But it's mainly staying around 65, 66 degrees Celsius is where we're seeing it. Just for fun, just for the lulls, I actually turned the case on its front side. So with the front panel facing on the surface of the desk, and just to see if thermals would change at all from opening up this this dust filter at the bottom here. And we actually saw a drop of around 2 to 3 degrees, which isn't phenomenal. I mean, if it was like a 10 degree delta or something like that, then, you know, then we're talking about a serious design flaw in the case, and Win has to go back to the drawing board. But just sort of a fun little experiment there. I mean, if you're a freak about thermals, I guess that's one way to run your system, but probably inconvenient for most people having the front IO on the bottom of your case. Moving on to acoustics, let's talk about noise. I mean, right now the system's idling, side panels off, microphone is probably around 8 or 9 inches away from the system, and you probably can't hear it much. It's very quiet. These Silent Series fans are doing a great job, especially the fan on the H5 there, and we have zero RPM fans on our graphics card there.
Are they running?
No, they're not running. That's good. So it is a very quiet system for day-to-day use. However, if you throw a heavy load on it, like rendering or gaming, those fans are gonna spin up, they're gonna speed up, and all of a sudden the system becomes much more audible. The main source of noise is coming from the GPU. It's got a triple fan design, but it's not as loud as it could be, to be honest. Because it's keeping the GPU so cool, relatively cool, the fans don't need to work as hard to maintain those temperatures. Additionally, while it doesn't go unnoticed when under load, if you happen to be listening to a game or movies or whatever with a pair of cans or through a set of speakers that are at medium or higher volume, this certainly doesn't pose too much of an issue. It's not gonna distract you or bring you out of those experiences. So I think that takes us to benchmarking. Pretty much we're using Wickeldriver 390.77, and I ran a couple synthetics and 6 different games at 1920 by 1080 and 2560 by 1440. I didn't do any 4K benchmarks here. Usually I cut that off at anything below a GTX 1080, simply because if you're buying a 1070 Ti right now, well, if you're buying a 1070 Ti right now, it means you're loaded for one. And additionally, you're probably gonna be gaming at 1080p, 1440p, you know, ultra wide resolutions, for example. So with that said, ladies and gentlemen, let's take it away to some benchmarks, accompanied of course by the face melting sounds of brutally hardcore metal music. All right, y'all, so there you guys have the results. Let's quickly talk about some of this data here before we close out. For starters, this system was able to pull off well over 60 FPS on average at both resolutions in every game except for Ashes of the Singularity, which wasn't even too far behind, hovering in the 50s. Even 1% lows, for that matter, were over 60 FPS in all but Ashes and GTA 5, with the exception of PUBG at 1440p, which scored around 47 FPS, but It's freaking PUBG, who cares? But still, really, really good numbers here. Ashes of the Singularity and GTA 5 were the only two titles where we actually saw some serious CPU bottlenecking, where there was next to no performance improvement going from 1440p to 1080p. So perhaps the 1800X could use maybe an upgrade to Ryzen second generation chip once those come out. That'd be an interesting test, actually. Rounding things out here, combining the frame rates of all the games we tested, we actually saw an average of 117 FPS at 1080p and 90 FPS on average at 1440p. Very, very respectable scores there. So altogether, I would be happy to call this a daily driver. It's quiet, it's cool, and it's pretty damn fast. It's the only problem with it is that it's gonna cost an arm and a leg, given the DRAM prices right now, and especially our graphic solution there. But overall, guys, that's December's PC of the Month, part two, fully tested. You guys let me know what you think in the comments below. That's gonna sum this video up for now. If you enjoyed the video, be sure to toss me a like on it before you go. You can also check me out on FLOATPLANE so you can watch content like this up to a week early without ads. Guys, go ahead and check it out. I'll put a link in the description below. Have a good one. Thank you so much for tuning in, and I will see y'all in the next video.